Welcome to TRICO. I'm Falguni Whedon, welcoming you to TRICO's 15th edition. Welcome to TRICO 2020. My name is Falguni Whedon, and I'm delighted to be sitting here today with Dr. Tejas Patel. Dr. Patel, welcome. TRICO 2020, our 15th edition, a global pioneer in your field. You've taken us from transradial to distal radial, OCT, robotics, telerobotics, a huge journey, then very recently awarded the highest award a civilian can receive from the Indian government. Your patients love and adore you. And now here we are, sitting here at the 15th edition of TRICO. Congratulations.
Thank you, Falguni.
Thank you. So let's start talking. I'd like to just take a few steps back. Let's talk about TRICO in its infancy and what led you to create TRICO from the very beginning.
I think it's a very interesting question. I am an interventional cardiologist doing angioplasty since 1991. It is when I was 28. And I grew up in a government institution, you know, where I used to work on very poor patients. And by 95, for some of my work on VAL, balloon mitral valvuloplasty, I was known all over the world for that particular procedure. And representing India for balloon mitral valvuloplasty on international stage at Chicago Mitral Balloon Valvuloplasty Meet organized by Ted Feldman, I came across Dr. Shigeru Saito and Dr. Inoue, who invented that balloon, because three of us were representing Asia and we became friends. And at that point of time, I was doing even good number of angioplasties also. Dr. Saito invited me to his place at Shunan Kamakura General Hospital at Kamakura, Japan. And he was doing a new technique, which was very new to the world. Everybody used to poke groin to enter the heart, and he was puncturing the wrist and was able to enter the heart and do anything to open up the blocks, and good results. And at that point of time, I thought that if short-statured Japanese population, if they are good for this particular small artery intervention, why not Indians? And that is how I started, very early stage in 1999-2000, I started working through the wrist. And I became popular. Although I did not invent that procedure, it was the initial pioneering work was by Dr. Kempau from Canada and Dr. Kimney from Netherlands and Dr. Saito, who tried to propagate. At least I have under my belt, you know, a credit to facelift this procedure by making it so simple.
Yes.
And by 2003-04, actually, I was done with almost 5,000-6,000 transradial, which was amongst one of the highest experience in the world. Then I thought, why not to impart my knowledge to the other young guys? So me and Sanjay, you know, thought of starting a transradial course. And I requested Dr. Saito, he also agreed. So between him, me and Sanjay, three course directors, first transradial intervention course was started way back in 2005. And initial attendance was about 200 interventional guys from India and few from Japan and other countries, US and Europe. First course was a big hit because there was no other agenda. I mean, no commercial angle, no discussion about any particular product or promotion of the product. It was all academics and do's and don'ts and tricks and traps mm-hmm. about the procedure, mm-hmm. how to do the puncture, how to enter. So everybody liked. Mm-hmm. So year by year, mm-hmm. the course grew, mm-hmm. and we were able to attract a lot of international, you know, authorities mm-hmm. to come as international guest faculty mm-hmm. again. To share their knowledge mm-hmm. with the young crowd. This course is mostly being attended by young guys who are in their practice from 1 year to 5 year or 10 year. Mm-hmm. And they learn, they go back, they practice. If they have any problem, they communicate with us, mm-hmm. we guide. Mm-hmm. So this journey started and it became more and more popular. And we started, you know, different applications through this route. And by 2014-15, we were able to train more than 5,000 interventional cardiologists from mm. India and all over the world. Mm.
And we've recently seen a name change, a tagline change for this year, for the 15th edition, yeah. to transcatheter intervention course. Can you expand on that a little
yeah.
bit for us?
See, TRICO is the acronym for transradial intervention course, because everything which is, all the procedures which were done, they were to be done through the radial route, that is the artery of the wrist. Mm. Now, I personally feel, and my partner Sanjay also feels, that I think everybody knows radial, and radial is the mainstream. Mm. So, nothing much to talk and discuss about it. So, I thought of changing gears. I thought that now let us widen, you know, the prospects of this course. Mm. And let us add some new procedures, imaging, robotics, physiology, and structural. And of course, some very complex peripheral artery intervention, may it be radial, may it be femoral. So we thought of giving new name to the course. But you know, TRICO, the name TRICO is so much near to my heart, and it is so much near to hearts of many, many cardiologists across the world. So I did not want to change this brand.
No.
So I thought of transradial, instead of transradial intervention course, I thought of transcatheter intervention course, mm. and it served our purpose. The same name, the same logo, mm. but instead of radial, it is transcatheter. It means that we have widened the prospects.
Yes.
We can do anything and teach anything to the participants, mm. and I think we are very successful.
Yes.
Yesterday you saw, I think, lots and lots of imaging, mm. robotics,
yes.
rotational atherectomy cases, lot of discussion on new emerging modalities.
Yes.
And everybody were very happy mm. to participate and discuss mm. and share their knowledge and share their problems,
yes.
and do's and don'ts.
And let's talk a little bit about technology. Technology is changing the face of healthcare in terms of the level of precision. We've seen OCT imaging, robotics, now you've moved us to telerobotics, having performed the first 5 cases yeah. globally and publication in The Lancet. Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Let's talk a little bit about how you see robotics/telerobotics/technology moving us forward. You're a fearless pioneer. That's what you're known for amongst your colleagues, your peers, your friends. Where can technology, robotics, etc., where can that take us next?
Yeah, let me tell you the history. The story is like this. In year 2016, there was a little buzz about the robotic PCI across the globe, mm-hmm. and I saw one robotic case being done at Columbia Presbyterian Hospital, very famous place in New York, by my friend Dr. Manish Parikh. And I was sold out. I thought that we should have a robot. Although it is very new, this technology has a lot of scope for you know, adding a lot of artificial intelligence improvement and making the things absolutely different. Mm. But I thought of having it at Apex. All my well-wishers, friends and advisors discouraged me mm. because there were no data mm. about this new technology. Mm. But I was convinced, not only convinced, I was adamant to buy it. Mm. Why? Because of only one reason, that in whatever field robo has been introduced, may it be the field of surgery or medicine, may it be the telemedicine, may it be engineering, may it be information technology, or may it be any field, wherever robo has been introduced, it has created its own place, its own unique place, and it has only enhanced the functioning and progress of that technology. Because robo, what is robo? Robo is a creation, collectively by many, many smart brains. They collectively get together and they create a brain which has smartness of several hundred brains, all artificial intelligence. And it is being operated by a smart brain, so it has to perform and it has to outperform. This was my thinking. On that ground, I bought robo. We have robo, got installed, and within 2 years, we became the world leaders in robotic PCI. We did now almost 550 robotic cases, and we had under our belt a first in human proof of principle study, that is distant telerobotic. You know, distant telerobotic, 32 kilometer away, Akshardham temple, I was sitting on the console and was using internet bandwidth. You know, with robotic, we gave command to the robo at Apex. My partner Sanjay with the team was on that side. And five consecutive cases we fixed, you know. So it's like this is just the beginning. Could anybody have imagined in 1950s where regular telephones were available, could anybody have imagined cell phone where you can talk to each other from 1,000 miles and thousands of miles without any problem? Could anybody have imagined that you can see each other and talk? Or could anybody have imagined that, you know, you can translate any language, you know, by phone? So this is exactly the beginning of the transformation of the regular wired telephone to the mobile, the high-tech mobile. The same thing is going on with this technology.
And you clearly feel that using this form of new technology, we can reach, for instance, some of the more distant areas where patients perhaps don't have access to cities, to medical treatment?
This is the sole motto. There are two very important conditions where the time can be considered the muscle. Acute heart attack and acute stroke, where there is something known as the golden period. That is initial 3 to 6 hours. If the patient is being identified and the problem is being addressed in that point of time, you are halting the process and you are reverting the process. And if you waste time, you are creating permanent damage to that particular organ. So this happens with acute heart attack and acute stroke. To prevent permanent damage to the heart and to prevent permanent damage to the brain, like supposing underprivileged areas are there everywhere in the world. Third world countries, of course, India and surrounding developing countries have underprivileged area. Forget about this place. Even in United States, the patient in Wyoming or patient in Idaho or patient in Nebraska, in some interior, they don't avail the facility of treating acute heart attack. Many places, acute heart attack or acute stroke. And they airlift the patient, or here they shift in the ICU, ICU ambulance on the road, and they waste time. There is mortality, there is morbidity. All this can be prevented. Young guys, they go there, they work there to start with, but they have no experience handling this complex situation. They just fix the patient on robo, and a senior person sitting 100 mile or 1,000 mile away on a console, you know, will give command to the robo. He can see the patient, he can see the guy who is assisting him over there on the spot. He can talk with, and he can fix the problem. Is that something really not exciting? I think so.
It's hugely exciting, and it really can change the face of healthcare. It can change the face of how patients, as we said, in poorer communities, in communities which are further away, access a more level playing field of treatment in the healthcare market today. Let me go on by asking you, if you could have a wish list of any future technologies to be developed or to look into or to drive you forward, what would they be?
A lot. I think if you see, transradial intervention course is now transcatheter intervention course. A lot of imaging, a lot of physiology, peripheral we have introduced. I have planned in subsequent years to add a lot of structural intervention. Every single young cardiologist wants to learn TAVR, that is transcatheter aortic valve replacement. Yes. They want to learn LA appendage occlusal implantation. Uh-huh. They want to learn treatment of mitral valve, mitral clip for acute regurgitation, and future, of course, percutaneous mitral valve replacement. All these procedures, I want to, you know, show them in TRICO, because all my international friends, many of them are world authorities on this. Like Dr. Saito is now in a big way with transcatheter aortic valve replacement, and Mauricio, and so many, Rajiv Gulati. I think these are the people from whom we will learn, and then we will impart our knowledge to the young cardiologists of this country and other countries.
Yes.
I think this is going to help us, and this is going to help them too.
And we saw a lot of live and very exciting cases yesterday. I had the privilege to sit with many of the faculty members and have a very brief chat with them. We dragged them away from either Apex or from downstairs where they were moderating. Were there any particular moments, highlights for you in the live cases yesterday?
I think every single case was highlight in its own respect. From the first case up to the 9th or 10th case we did, I showed 3 cases, Dr. Saito showed 2 extremely difficult cases, our friend Dr. Tak Kwan showed a case, and Dr. Aaron Grantham. I think everybody was at his best yesterday, and very difficult cases were done. And all do's and don'ts were discussed, and the traps were discussed, the tricks to come out of the trap were given, lot of plan B were discussed, if you get stuck, what to do, what next, everything. And at night in gala dinner, so many young guys, they told me that, Dr. Patel, we will be very happy to come every year to attend this.
Yes.
Yeah, this really helps us in our practice.
Yes. And we saw last night at the gala dinner, I personally saw a big queue of people wanting to take a photograph with you. Oh. You really are very, very inspirational to so many of the young cardiologists coming through. Any messages that you'd like to either give to the auditorium watching or to perhaps people watching online?
Yeah. This may sound, they are all good. See, every generation thinks that the subsequent generation is not up to the mark, but I have a different view. Many of them, they think that the subsequent generation is more smarter and better than the previous generation, by all means. So I'm very happy for them. But there is a message of caution. There is only one difference I see, my generation, the generation which was previous generation to me, the senior guys, maybe Dr. Saito, Dr. Malcolm Bell, John Coppola, then my generation, we, during the course of our professional career, we never tried to find any shortcut. There is no shortcut to the hard work. There is nothing like 1 + 1 = 2 in this field. So it is my message to the young generation that you have to be patient, you have to invest a lot of time and energy to develop your skills and to be a good professional. There is no shortcut to the story. because sometimes young guys, they just pass and they see us doing the cases and they want to do those cases right away and they'll end up with very, very, very big complications. Mm. So there is no shortcut to this story. Like 1 + 1 = 2, you know, is true for mathematics. Mm. These principles are true for physics or the space science where everything, you know, is as per the protocol. Mm. Medicine is a different science where you have to have, apart from good knowledge, you should have a lot of common sense, a capacity to work hard, a capacity to withstand frustrations, because time and again you get frustrated because you confront with failures, and to capacity to come out of it and develop yourself, and you must know what are your limitations.
Yes.
If one knows this, you know, the success is guaranteed.
Dr. Tejas Patel from TRICO 2020, 15th edition, we thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Falguni.
Thank you.
Thanks for inviting me. Thank you very much.
Thank you.